Admiral Olson is the first Navy SEAL to be promoted to three-star rank in 2003, was the first Navy SEAL to be promoted to four-star rank, was the first naval officer to command U.S. Special Operations, so U.S. SOCOM, which is all of the special operations in the U.S. military. He was the first Naval Academy grad to be the Bullfrog, which is an honorary title held by the longest-serving SEAL on active duty.
Nothing to do with quality, just longevity.
During his tenure, Admiral Olson commanded Naval Special Warfare Command, which is the entire SEAL force. Admiral Olson's actions as a Navy SEAL and Special Operations Commanding Officer have been of national importance and obviously of utmost secrecy. Although we do know, you know, some details of a few of the operations he was involved in, notably Admiral Olson received the Silver Star for Valor in the Battle of Mogadishu, Somalia, that was depicted in the film Black Hawk Down. As SOCOM commander, he also played a central role in the 2011 Navy SEAL raid in Pakistan that resulted in the death of Osama bin Laden. Admiral Olson's also a director of the Special Operations Warrior Foundation. Thank you very much for being here. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Jack. And I'm really honored to be with you, so thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you. You know, one thing that would be helpful, what we're trying to do in the short period of time we have, is to help get a perspective on geopolitical threats around the world, while at the same time really bringing your community, the SEAL community, and the Special Operations community to life. Well, maybe what we can do, let's take it top of mind these days and threats around the world, ISIS, of course.
Yep.
Could you maybe set the stage for us a little bit? Give us a little bit of the background and the creation of ISIS, how they got to where they were as a context for, as we talk about where do we go going forward and how do you deal with a threat like that?
I mean, I think most people recognize the core of ISIS was the residue of the Ba'athist army that was eliminated as an army by decisions made by Americans early after the invasion into Iraq in 2003. And these Ba'athist army soldiers and officers didn't have anybody to work for. And so an organization was created around that core, trained, motivated people who were willing to sort of form an opposition group, a terrorist group, a criminal group, in order to achieve a set of means that was not available to them under the political structure in Iraq at the time. As Iraq became more stable, got pushed across the border and straddled the Iraqi-Syria border, found more open areas where they had more freedom of movement, more sanctuary, started to control the cities and the roads in between them, and by doing that, ended up controlling fairly significant amounts of territory. And they did it in a brutal kind of a way, so that people were afraid and intimidated by them every step of the way. And this is a complex problem. It's not contained. They've a lot of evidence that it's expeditionary in nature, that people don't have to go to Iraq or Syria to fight for ISIS if they are ideologically subscribed to it, but still some opportunity to export from Iraq and Syria to other places in the world in order to conduct some of the more explosive, dramatic kinds of attacks that have captured the attention of the world and that contribute to recruiting for ISIS itself. It's a very, very complex thing. It's not going to go away anytime soon. And I'm happy to talk about sort of what I think we ought to be doing in order to address it.
No, that would be helpful.
So my sense is that, you know, we, the military, can beat back ISIS, some within its own contained sanctuary. We can diminish their capabilities. To some degree, we can eliminate their leadership, their logistics capability, some of their financial capabilities. We can sort of beat them down, but we can't shout them down. And in order for ISIS to be truly defeated, it has to be erased as an ideology or a theology that is attractive to other people, and America is not a credible voice in carrying that message. That message has to come out of the Muslim world, primarily the Sunni Muslim world, because ISIS is fundamentally a Sunni a radical Sunni group. And this is 17-dimensional chess, or some number of dimensions. You've got a Shia leader in Syria, you've got a Shia leader in Iraq, you've got a Shia government in Iran, and the broad Sunni populations who aren't subscribed to ISIS are still holding this poker chip in their hand, trying to determine whether or not to place it on ISIS as the enemy of the Shias, or place it on the Shias, who they consider to be their enemies as well, and subject themselves to living under Shia governance. So I think, as we find in many movements, a broad population that feels like it's been suppressed or disadvantaged over time by the conditions in the region or the environment in which they live will tend to be silent observers of a more radical element that claims to operate to a degree on their behalf. And I think that can only be, again, shouted down by meaningful, serious, respected Sunni leaders in the region. And we haven't seen too much of that.
So now we have other countries involved. Russia's come in, obviously. Yep. France is becoming much more active. Jordan. Yep. How do you view that? Is this then a coalition that can come together in a good way, or does this then lead to more serious issues between stronger powers as everybody focuses on that one area? And obviously there's been skirmishes and challenges right now.
Well, there's going to have to be some political arrangements made that are not comfortable for us, that are not historic for us. We have to recognize that, and I think Queen Rania of Jordan said it well a few days ago. She said, we as a planet have to recognize that it is ISIS against a global community. And at some level, we're going to have to set aside other differences to focus on ISIS if it becomes a priority to defeat ISIS, and then sort of get back to the rest of it. But as long as ISIS is there as a disruptive element, sort of everything else is happening in the context of ISIS, and that's not a comfortable place to be.
Well, that gives you some optimism then, if people are really talking about, okay, let's put everything off to the side, let's solve this problem. It might make you think that you could solve that problem.
It would give me optimism if people were talking about that, yeah. So I think we have a ways to go to stimulate that discussion.
So as you think about this threat, the one you're dealing with in real time always seems worse because it hasn't been solved yet. Is this much more serious and difficult than threats we've faced in the past?
Well, I think
how do you put it in perspective?
It's symbolic of a shifting kind of a geopolitical structure, a more globalized, a less nation-state versus nation-state kind of a competition. Military competition, where you've got proxies like Lebanese Hezbollah, you've got sub-state actors, terrorist groups, cyberist groups, all acting not on behalf of nation states, but acting in their own interest, sometimes supported by nation states, but acting mostly in their own interest. And so that creates a complexity that didn't exist before. A nation state versus a nation state generally leads to some sort of a victory. There is a victory and a loser, and some sort of agreement is signed, and then you get on with whatever's going to come next. That's not going to happen here. We are not dealing with a nation state. We are dealing with a movement. And if and when we defeat ISIS, we won't know that we've defeated it. We won't know for how long it's been defeated. And at any time after that, that movement can regenerate itself. It's interesting that Ba'athist, the party that was the source of much of ISIS, Ba'athist translates to resurrection, and they've proven their ability to resurrect themselves.
I guess as you think about Al-Qaeda, right, I guess was the early formation, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, moving into ISIS, but in Afghanistan, maybe it's just because I'm following more the media cycle than somebody who's really in the know. Have they been largely neutered in Afghanistan? So have you been able to you know, put down a group like that? Is that instructive for us?
My sense of Al-Qaeda is that Al-Qaeda 2.0 or 3.0 or however you count it hasn't emerged. If the death of bin Laden was the end of Al-Qaeda 1.0 or something beyond that, but it hasn't fully emerged. Zawahiri is still the leader, who was bin Laden's number two. They are still franchised. But I think that when Al-Qaeda does emerge in its next version, its ideology will not have changed, but its technologies will have advanced, its personnel will have changed, there will be more dual passport holders and foreign citizens among them, their expeditionary capability will have advanced, and they will be quite dangerous. I think now that Al-Qaeda is just kind of taking a knee, waiting for ISIS to sort of play out. And in fact, the Al-Qaeda element in Iraq, al-Nusra, is in conflict with ISIS in Iraq and Syria. So
I can't imagine they're joining the coalition.
No, I think Al-Qaeda is not, at this point, wanting to take on ISIS.
Yeah.
And not wanting to join ISIS either.
Let's switch a little bit to, just for our audience, describe the state of the Special Operations Command and put it in perspective for people, size, mission, capability.
The United States Special Operations Command was born out of failure. In 1980, a helicopter and an airplane crashed into each other at a place known as Desert One in the remote section of Iranian desert on their way to rescue 54 Americans who were held in Tehran. And that mission was canceled at that moment. It was a failed mission. And in the aftermath of that, the United States Special Operations Command was established to ensure that should America have to do that kind of an operation again, which involved all the services and a complex environment, that we would be more ready to do so. So United States Special Operations Command was formed. Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps elements, 70,000 people or so, wake up every day in 75 countries of the world over the course of a year. They seem to be the fighting solution to many of our problems. What you don't read a lot about is that they're also just out there establishing relationships, learning languages, gaining future access to places should we need it, conducting training. Under the theory that it's always better to help somebody solve their problems than try to solve their problems for them. In fact, one of my favorite quotes is, when the map differs from the terrain, you got to go with the terrain. And the reality of being able to sort of adjust to life on the ground and solve problems as they occur is a forte of the Special Operations Community.
That community, you guys have a culture, you develop a culture of people who are elite warriors, yet also are not necessarily wearing it on their sleeves. How do you develop that within the teams?
Yeah, so it's all about the mission. I think the most important thing is to know your purpose. And once you know your purpose, and then you get the people and the equipment and the training and the organization that's focused on that purpose, then it creates a culture of its own. You spend a lot of time together, you learn each other's strengths and weaknesses. You learn how to instinctively make up for each other in your team, or they learn to make up for you. Everybody knows that they've got to carry their own load. They can't pass off any of their responsibility. Your operational reputation is everything, and so you don't do anything that will decrease your operational reputation, which mostly has to do with your classic warrior type skills: shooting, jumping, diving, patrolling, being able to use the technologies on the target, and being a good teammate. And so that's the culture of the community. And it tends to attract a certain person who subscribes to that. It's not for everybody. But the selection process is a good process. And if I can digress a minute, this is just kind of an interesting thing that we found when we studied the SEAL community, since we're talking about SEALs, a few years ago. We knew that about 75% of the people who started SEAL training didn't complete it. Everybody thought they were going to. They all passed through a number of filters, got the recommendations, had clean records, passed the physical fitness test. They all walked in the front door of SEAL training thinking 6 months later they were going to graduate, and only 25% did. So we knew that most of the people who didn't make it because they quit. Something demotivated them or seemed too hard to them along the way, and we make it easy to quit. We give you several opportunities today to quit, and you just ring a bell, drop your helmet on the ground, walk out the door, no questions asked, you're never invited back. So then we wanted to get into the next level of quitting. Why and when did people quit? And it turned out that more than two-thirds, almost three-quarters of the people who quit didn't quit in the middle of something hard. They quit at breakfast or at lunch. And for me, this is a real epiphany that most, and it wasn't because the food was bad, it was most people didn't achieve their dream because they eliminated themselves from it. And they didn't want to fail, because failure has this whole other connotation. It's much easier to say to somebody you're close to, your wife, your girlfriend, your brother, your mom, I just decided it wasn't for me, so I quit at breakfast time because I just didn't want to do it anymore, than to say, I couldn't make that swim, or I couldn't make that climb, I couldn't run the obstacle course. But we found that almost everybody who starts that hard thing finishes it. They find the strength to finish it, they're urged on by their teammates, they see the leadership, they get inspired to do it. And almost nobody quits in the middle of something, they always quit before something. So for me, that was an important life lesson.
And I guess as you think about it, you're really designing the organization to produce the guy who's going to be side by side with you when bad things happen. So as you go through that, it's a selection process, it's a development process. But if you know, in that toughest time, right, what leadership lessons could we learn from your experience?
Yeah, so the most important thing was to find the guys who wouldn't quit. Character, real character, can be faked when times are good. Character can't be faked when times are really bad. And in order to operate at the levels that we ask our teams to operate, and frankly, the levels at which your teams are asked to operate, you've got to have confidence in the character of the people, that they won't take the easy way out. And I think it's really important for the leaders to listen to the people in their teams, partly because leaders have a tendency to fall in love with their own thinking and their own plan, and limit themselves to that can be disastrous in a complex situation. So this idea of really being open-eared to the people in your team is one of the leadership traits that we value in our community. I think that most SEALs will tell you that they felt their leadership was open to their suggestions. They might reject them, absolutely, but at least they were open to listening to them, and that's an important leadership trait.
And I think everybody will join me in thanking you for spending some time.
Yeah, thanks.